southern trees bear a strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the root.
When people first heard Billie Holiday sing Strange Fruit in 1938, it was different from anything they had heard before. Its dark melody and vivid lyrics describing a lynching moved listeners tremendously. The song was written by communist schoolteacher Abel Mirapol and first published as the poem Bitter Fruit in 1937. He eventually put it to music and introduced it to jazz star Billie Holiday. Strange Fruit was controversial for its graphic depiction of a lynching and for its aggressiveness in a push for racial justice. By creating and associating themselves with the song, Mirapol and Holiday risked their careers, lives, and economic well-being to bring the controversial issue to the public's attention. Lynching, a common practice by whites against African Americans in the South from Reconstruction until World War II, is an extralegal murder, usually a mob-imposed punishment for an alleged crime.
The most prominent would be having a white woman claim an assault or having a white victim claim to have been offended or assaulted in some way.
Lynchings were commonly done by hanging. They were gruesome spectacles attended by large crowds, often whole towns, as carnival-like events. Families would come and bring young children. Frequently, body parts of the victim, such as fingers, toes, or even genitals, were cut off and given away as souvenirs. While lynchings were normally carried out as punishment for an alleged crime, the claims of white perpetrators were almost always false, and based on violations of unjust laws called black codes that required African Americans to act subservient to whites. There were over 4,500 lynchings of African Americans between 1890 and 1950. It was extremely rare for a perpetrator to face any punishment. No federal anti-lynching laws were ever enacted. Several states did pass such laws, but they were never enforced.
So there were two attempts to pass federal legislation that would either punish local law enforcement officials for enabling lynchings or punish private citizens for participating in lynchings. Neither of these attempts was successful in ever actually passing the legislation.
It was widely thought that lynchings were one of the ways whites prevented African Americans from challenging the socioeconomic hierarchy of the South. Born into a Jewish family in 1903, Abel Mirapol was a high school English teacher in New York City in the 1930s and was a member of the American Communist Party. At that time, the Communist Party was a major activist for civil rights.
One of the Communist Party's main planks, if you will, was against discrimination and for integration, and for the fair treatment of what in those days were, you'd call them Negroes.
In 1936 or 37, Mirapol saw a postcard showing the horrific lynching of Thomas Shipp and Abram Smith. He was so appalled, he wrote the poem Bitter Fruit.
Well, he was once quoted as saying, "I wrote Strange Fruit because I hate lynching and I hate the people who perpetrate lynching." Abel was no turn the other cheek, forgive my enemy type person. As far as he was concerned, he wrote Strange Fruit to attack those who were committing lynching.
The poem was published in the communist newspaper The New Masses under Mirapol's pen name Lewis Allen. Mirapol, who was also a songwriter, set the poem to music and retitled it Strange Fruit. He and his wife sang the song at communist gatherings, as did blues musician and fellow communist Josh White.
Past a routine of the gallant South, the bulging eyes and the twisted mouth.
The song began to create controversy as it became more widely heard. In 1930s America, lynching was not openly discussed and even more rarely criticized. racial discrimination was the social norm. Mirapol was a frequent attendee at Café Society, the only racially integrated nightclub in New York City at the time. The club was a regular performance space for many of the premier African-American jazz artists of the day. Mirapol was friends with the owner, Barney Josephson. In 1938, Mirapol asked if he could offer the song to the club's house band singer, the young rising jazz star Billie Holiday. Holiday agreed to sing Strange Fruit. Josephson advised her to sing it last in her set, without an encore. He had the servers stop serving so there would be an absolute silence. Holiday sang the song standing still, with only a single spotlight shining on her. Holiday had a reputation for performing with deep emotion. She sang Strange Fruit with a dramatic intensity, conveying feelings of sadness, anger, and melancholy, despite singing for only 100 seconds and singing just 12 lines.
Everybody's swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
I think what made people so drawn to the song in 1939 was when Billie Holiday sang it, there was a way that she became the part, and people almost felt as though they were witnessing it.
Her performance regularly left people in tears. Word of Holiday's incredible performances spread, and people began to make special trips to Café Society to see her. It took Holiday years before she felt comfortable singing it outside Café Society, and then only in places where she thought the audience would be receptive. Yet, the song still caused significant controversy. Some audience members walked out, and there were frequently protests when Holiday sang it. She even received death threats. Holiday risked her career and her life to bring people's attention to the abomination of lynching.
Southern trees bear a strange fruit, blood on the leaves, and blood at the root.
But Holiday accepted this risk. In 1939, she asked to record the song. Her label, Columbia Records, refused to produce it, claiming that it would upset their Southern audience. But Columbia did release her from her contract so that she could record the song for the smaller Commodore Records label. Columbia agreed to re-sign her after she recorded the song. While Strange Fruit was not commercially successful upon its release, it eventually sold over 1 million copies and brought critical attention to lynching. By dramatizing the horrors in an intimate and powerful way, it made millions of people directly aware of and uncomfortable with the practice.
There was instantly a debate about it. So there were those who praised her and praised it and said things need to change.
While listeners back then were captivated by the song, today we can understand why it was able to have such an impact. Scientific research has shown that music is one of the most powerful forms of communication, affecting people's emotions and memories, as well as their conscious thought. Still, Strange Fruit is unique in its immense power, one of only a few songs that conveys the terror of injustice so compellingly.
It is really what we call a witnessing song. It is making you aware of a problem by showing the horrid atrocity, the violence that's related with racism.
Some of its power comes from the haunting melody, full of minor intervals, unexpected jumps, and sudden changes in intensity. Some also comes from the lyrics, juxtaposing Southern ideals of beauty and elegance with gruesome details of a lynching.
Pastoral scene of the gallant South, the bulging eyes and the twisted mouth.
But it was Billie Holiday's captivating performance, her passion, sadness, and fury, that made and still makes the song so potent. In response to Strange Fruit, the FBI opened a file on Mirapol and followed him for 40 years. In 1940, he was called before the New York State Congressional Committee investigating communist teachers and asked about Strange Fruit and whether the Communist Party paid him to write it.
This is Abel Mirapol's FBI file. This is how thick it is. It's you can tell in typical fashion, you know, like things are blacked out. So, you know, I've got the file here, but I can't really read anything. you know, read everything. It wasn't, they opened it in the, you know, late 1930s. They didn't close it until the 1970s. So for 40 years, the FBI kept track of him, mostly because of Strange Fruit.
Meeropol's reputation suffered because of his association with Strange Fruit. He was considered an activist and had difficulty finding work.
And he was concerned that he might lose his job, and Strange Fruit would be the main reason.
Many believe that Holiday's singing of Strange Fruit led police to target her. She was eventually arrested for possession of heroin. While admittedly a crime, it was a very common habit of celebrities of her era, and very few were ever arrested for it. Her arrest jeopardized the rest of her career, and hastened her untimely death at age 44. In the 1940s, Meeropol became a songwriter full-time. His other most well-known work is Frank Sinatra's 1945 song, The House I Live In, about the beauty of diversity in America. In 1958, Meeropol continued his legacy of empathy, when he and his wife adopted Robert and Michael, the children of the alleged Soviet spies Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, who were executed for treason. Lynching came to an end after World War II, due not to laws, but to increased awareness and outrage at its inherent injustice and grisly nature. Unfortunately, it was replaced by subtler forms of prejudice in our criminal justice system.
Those who were most supportive of lynchings become more assured that traditional criminal justice structures would, in many cases, render a state execution of the person that those same individuals wanted to execute via mob justice.
It is impossible to know exactly what impact Strange Fruit had on the decline of lynching, but it clearly led to more awareness of the cruel practice. Many people consider Strange Fruit instrumental to the start of the civil rights movement. It inspired other musicians to write songs about race and racism, such as Duke Ellington's Black, Brown, and Beige, which prompted wider social engagement with racial issues. And see my people through. Over the years, Strange Fruit has sparked many protest songs, helping to promote a culture of protest in the music world. It inspired renowned jazz singer, songwriter, and civil rights activist Nina Simone, and one of her most well-known works, the protest song Mississippi Goddamn.
Tennessee made me lose my rest, and everybody knows about Mississippi Goddamn.
Strange Fruit has been covered dozens of times by an incredible diversity of artists, including Simone herself. Many artists today, especially in hip-hop, still reference Strange Fruit in their own protest songs, especially those taking on issues of racial justice.
It's that sort of thinking that been keeping niggas chained at the bottom and hang the strangest fruit that you ever seen, right with pain, listen.
Please, Mother Magnolia, although the fruit is strange, it's been such a long time coming, when will the seasons ever change?
With Strange Fruit, Meeropol and Holiday took a compelling stand against lynching, using the unique power of music's emotion and poignancy to effectively communicate the horror of lynching to millions of people who would not have understood it otherwise.
For the sun to rot, for the tree to drop, here is a strange